And Kaylee Chelios, Lightning reporter and radio analyst down there in Tampa. Kaylee, Andre Vasilevsky returning to the lineup tonight between the pipes. What should we expect to see from him?
Yeah, I mean, I think he's excited, obviously, and there's probably a lot of adrenaline going, and this is no doubt going to be a huge challenge for him, having to, obviously, his first game back, have to go against a high-powered offense and one of the scoringest teams in the NHL and the Toronto Maple Leafs. So I think hopefully, you know, he's going to hope that he's comfortable off the start, but his team is obviously going to want to play a good style of defense in front of him. They're going to want to stay disciplined because Toronto obviously generates so many scoring chances on their power play, and they don't want to get caught, you know, in this battle of the blue lines turning pucks over. So I think Vasilevsky is excited. I mean, he got back, I think, sooner than people expected him to. When he left, he was at the, you know, at the top of the charts as far as wins among goalies. And Louis Domingue admirably stepped up in his absence. And he also was at the top of the charts with Pekka Rinne and other goaltenders as far as wins. But definitely looking forward to being back in the lineup. And I'm sure he's looking to try to get comfortable, get some early shots on him, and get the support that he needs from his teammates above him.
All right, Vassie's back in tonight. Anton Strowman's still out, but how has Eric Cernak filled in his absence?
He's been really, really good. I think everybody's been really impressed with him. He came into camp, obviously, and you know he set a precedence there. He came in faster, stronger, bigger, and I think he's even exceeded expectations, just his consistency. He brings a physical element to the game. Braden Point said this morning he kind of brings that extra bite. And he just brings it size and skill. And on top of it, he's really good with the puck. He moves really well. And he's kind of evolved from just kind of bringing that simple game. He brings a little bit of an offensive game as well. And he drew a penalty against the Rangers to kind of kickstart the Lightning power play. It led to a Steven Stamkos goal in the last game. But he's been really good. He brings that physical presence and kind of that edge that maybe the Lightning want to see, especially in their top four decor. So I don't think there's any rush for Anton Strowman to get back with how well he's played and how well the team as a whole has played with him.
Plenty of offense on both sides in this matchup tonight. What's Tampa's main focus tonight facing that high-powered offense from Toronto?
Yeah, I think for fans, obviously, they'd love to see a game like, you know, the Rams-Chiefs where it's just high-scoring. It's so fun. But for the goaltenders and the coaches, obviously, they want to see a more defensive game maybe from their players. So I think when you have two teams like this, you don't know what to expect. Is it going to be this high-scoring game or are they going to have to make sure that they're taking care of the puck with how good both these two teams are in transition? They don't want to be turning the puck over in the Lightning in their last seven wins. And just as of late in the month of November, going into December, they've been finding different ways to win every night. They're, as you said earlier, averaging four goals a game. They've scored five or more, I think, in six of their last seven games. So they're finding ways to win every night. It's different players on the score sheet every single night. And on top of that, they're defending well, and the defense is starting to contribute as well on offense without sacrificing in their own end. So they're finding different ways. They're playing consistent hockey, and obviously when you're on a seven-game win streak, your confidence and the morale in the locker room is really high right now. So they're a dangerous team going against Toronto tonight.
Yeah, everything's working right now for the Bolts. We know about the big names for that team. What about these secondary contributions? How have those guys helped out?
Yeah, Anthony Cirelli, Matthew Joseph, two rookies and two additions this season that I think have been tremendous for the Lightning. And kind of what Braden Point talked about this morning was just their confidence. I mean, when Braden Point came into the league, he had talked about just having to play every game like he wasn't going to be on the team the next night. That's exactly what Matthew Joseph and Anthony Cirelli do as well. It's all-out effort. And with confidence, you know, they're finding ways to contribute. All three of these players, Joseph, Cirelli, and Paquette, are nearing double digits in goals right now, which I don't think anybody expected this early on in the season. So they've been scoring not just, you know, goals, but the key goals and the timely ones, and they're getting the timely saves from Louis Domingue. So all together, the secondary scoring, it's just talking to the depth that this team has, both in the net and up front as well. You can move Cirelli or Joseph up and down the lineup. They're two-way players. They're used on special teams. Anthony Cirelli especially has been tremendous to watch on the penalty kill. Really great hockey IQs. And I think, you know, people don't see how fast he is maybe just because he's a little bit taller. He has that longer stride. But Anthony Cirelli is a really fast player. And obviously we've seen how impressive Matthew Joseph is end-to-end.
All right. It's the game of the night down there at Tampa. We are envious that you were down there. We'll watch it from afar. But Kaylee, appreciate the insight and the preview. And we'll talk to you again soon, okay?
Yep. Thank you.
Time now for a ring demo presented by Bauer here with Leetsy and Johnny. And if a guy like Max Domi wanted the hockey spotlight on him, he got it in Montreal. He didn't only get it, he's thriving with it. Why?
Well, I think part of it is that he is in that hockey spotlight. He grew up as Ty Domi's son in the Toronto area, so he knows what it's all about to have pressure and attention and a lot of media around, and he likes it. And he's comfortable in his own skin, in his own game, to play like that and not worry about the downside of potential criticism. But also, when he went to Montreal, they turned him into a centerman. Now, Max played a little bit of center in Arizona, a little bit of center for the London Knights, but mostly he's played wing throughout his NHL career and mostly in junior as well. But you put a guy in the center, Jameson, and you have to do a few things. Things that Max Domi is really good at. You first and foremost have to skate. If you don't skate as a centerman, you have no chance of being an effective player. And Max, I'll tell you from watching him firsthand several times, is a way better skater than I gave him credit for. So when you move your feet and get up and down the ice like he can, then you give yourself some opportunities. The other thing is, he's a great passer. And if you're going to play in the middle and you're going to be an offensive guy, the puck's going to be on your stick. You're going to be facilitating, moving yourself and your line mates up and down the ice. And the other part about it, when you play center, you're around the puck more. You're more physical, you're more emotional, you're more engaged. All things that Max Domi does really well. So it's no surprise that he's been good. So we'll show some of the situations where Max Domi as a winger versus a centerman gets himself in different situations. So you're going to be the winger in this situation. We're breaking out our own. You're playing right wing over there. I'm in the middle. I'm Max. So battles behind the net. Mm-hmm. Weeksy's talking it out.
Heads up. Hard around.
I'm back here. So I'm battling. I'm working. I'm Max Domi down low. Puck gets over here to you. Mm-hmm. So you're probably stationary, which is a tough place to be for a winger sometimes because you oftentimes have to chip it out or pass in the middle and you're still standing still. Yep. But I'm coming out of the corner, I'm Max Domi, and I'm flying. I'm skating, I'm moving, I'm hustling. I want that puck and speed, and now I'm getting it, attacking, head up, middle of the ice. That's a spot where his skills, once he gets it moving, are going to really take advantage. So that's certainly one part of it, flowing to the puck in his own end, able to keep it and go full speed and attack through off the rush, which he's really good at. The other part of it is now, Jameson, you're on the other team. You're in the corner.
Okay.
So if I'm the centerman, one of my responsibilities, generally speaking, if I'm the first guy back with a defenseman, is I'm the guy who has to go down low. Now, one thing about Max Domi, when you watch him play, he's physical.
Yeah, he is.
He's chippy, mm-hmm. and he doesn't mind getting in here.
Here we go.
And rubbing up, cross-check, push, shove, battling for loose pucks, trying to create a turnover. You get it, and then you have to move and go off the races. Again, it's the physical engagement that Max Domi has to go along the wall behind his own net. Now, a lot of people thought that that would be a challenge for him, because center is very different, more responsibility, patience, poise, and reads in around the net. But for Max, I look at it as a positive because it gets him bumping into people. He's a guy who plays better when it's physical. Yep. He plays better when he wants to get a little aggravated, get a little mean, get a little nasty, and he has more chances to do that as a centerman than he does as a winger. A winger, oftentimes, when he's Max Domi playing wing in Arizona, mm-hmm. I got my point, man. I'm covering here. I'm trying to pay attention. But I'm doing a lot of standing around.
Stationary.
Watching other people do work. The other guy you're watching work now is Max Domi down below the net. So I think that is a real key to him being really good in the center. And the other part is off the rush. Mm-hmm. Off the rush. So now we're going to attack on Kevin. Now you're my winger.
Ooh.
And this is where you see Max, underrated playmaker, because he can really get up the ice. Now, I'm a righty, he's a lefty, but him and Jonathan Drouin, whoever their other winger, have been really good. Andrew Shaw now as of late.
Dazzy, yep.
And he can really... Now, Max Domi had 9 goals last year.
Right.
Only 5 past the goal. He had 4 empty netters.
Yeah.
He only had 5
that
goals.
That was crazy.
And yet, I was doing a game the other day. The Montreal Canadiens had their nicknames on their jerseys to sell them off for charity. Weeksy, Johnny, J-Mo. His nickname was Shotzi.
No
Shotzi.
Way.
I'm like, Shotzi,
seriously?
You had 5 goals last year. Why are they calling
exactly.
you Shotzi? Right. Because he can shoot it.
Yeah. Wow.
And you see highlights of Max Domi when he plays now. So he's already above last year's goal totals.
Yeah.
And he can beat goaltenders with that speed. He's got a lot of torque on his stick, so he can come down off the rush. He's got Drouin, and and he takes shots, and he can go. But Cavs too good a goalie. We'll get through there somehow.
Get in there.
Oh, he's going to swing at it.
Still got it.
Still got it.
Of.
And the other part of it is that
he can
come and do a lot of this, where I sell the goaltender,
and
he finds his guys to make plays. So I look at the transition to center for Max Domi as something that really opened up his game. Yeah, there's challenges. His face-offs are not great yet, but nobody is really good at face-off their first time through. But the fact that it makes him skate, be emotional, be physical, and make him make plays are all things he does really well.
I totally agree.
How much do you credit Claude Julien for that, putting him in a situation to thrive there at center?
Well, I mean, it was a risky play. I mean, I think they traded Jonathan Drouin to be center.
Right.
And Claude Julien had to make the tough decision to pull Drouin out of center.
Mm-hmm.
They traded Galchenyuk, a centerman, for Domi, a perceived winger, and then they dumped a guy in a pretty high-profile trade to a position he hadn't played a lot of in the NHL, which also took some guts by Julien, but also some communication with Max.
Sure.
He talked to Max. Do you think you can do this? Can you handle it? What parts about being centerman will challenge you initially? What will you be comfortable with? And they have those kind of conversations like any good coach would and try to put him in the best position to be successful in a new spot. And he did that. So I give him a lot of credit because it was not an easy decision. And you couple the fact that Max didn't play any exhibition games because he got suspended. Yes, he played half of one game, got suspended for the rest of exhibition.
Yep.
You didn't even know what you really were going to get out of him when the games really mattered, and they still stuck with it. And now he's their number one center. He's a point-a-game player. He's a top 30 point getter in the NHL. Everything that Montreal was hoping that they would get out of any centerman, let alone Max Domi.
All right, so you learn what makes Max Domi go, and we learned his new nickname, Shotzi. If he keeps this up this year, maybe next year's nickname, Scorsi.
Oh, no? Okay, I like that.
I think it's Paisy.
Yeah, exactly. Creamy.
Yeah.
Oh. The game is a gift. Visit your local retailer or Bauer.com for great holiday hockey gifts.
But yeah, as far as guys who can straight up help their teammates out, these two are as good as it gets. And what they're so good at is drawing attention of the opposition and then putting their teammates into spots where they can make plays. So when you can draw one, two, three sets of eyes or a couple of bodies towards you, whether you're Kucherov or Marner, and you watch these clips, how many times these guys are so good that it takes more than one player to try to check them, and then that leaves a teammate open. And when you can skate like Mitch Marner can one-on-two, now you're going to have the entire team focus on Marner going around the net. You've brought both defensemen out of the way. And, yeah, well, there's Tavares for another. Listen, John Tavares is going to be so happy playing with Mitch Marner because he keeps nothing but tap-ins. Again, two guys focused in on Kucherov, and he has so much patience, so much poise that he puts the puck on his very talented teammate sticks, and good things that happen. How about this one? Everybody locked in on Marner. I would be too. He's got a great shot and chance to score. But even Tavares knows if I go to the back post, stick on the ice, he is good enough to get me that puck. Forehand, backhand, you name it. They just have the knack, the vision, and the wherewithal to spread it around. So time and again, and you'll see it in tonight's game. And you know you're told when you go on the ice, Jameson. When they have the puck, trust the guy checking them, and then do your job because they want to pass it to someone. But you just get mesmerized. They just are so talented at drawing it in and being patient and sucking you in and buying time. And all of a sudden, before you know it, you've drifted. You're paying attention. It's on the stick in the back of your net. They're both exceptional at it.
Trying to string a couple of wins back together again. For more on this one, we welcome in that man right there, Paul Hamilton, Sabres reporter for WGR Sports Radio. Carter Hutton returning from injury tonight. What should the team expect out of him?
Yeah, he's missed three games. I asked him this morning, talking for a little bit with him, for a goaltender, if it's a little bit different, and Darren would be able to answer this too, when you've missed three games, and he said, you know, it's not that long. He goes, you don't miss your timing when you're out that short a period of time. He goes, you actually maybe get a little bit rejuvenated from a mental standpoint and a physical standpoint. And it gave Linus Ullmark a chance to get three games in a row, something he hadn't been able to do yet since Hutton had a bulk of the goaltending for the Sabres. So it gave Ullmark a little chance to play three games in a row in the NHL, and now they're back to Carter Hutton.
All right. How have the Sabres played at home so far this season? How has that improved this season compared to years past?
It's been huge. I mean, they're 10-3-2 at home this year. Last year, it was an embarrassment, and Jason Botterill said so. He goes, our fans deserve better. We embarrassed ourselves at home. Last year, on the ticket broker sites, $6 tickets, and they couldn't even get rid of them there. People were eating their tickets. They didn't want to come watch. In November, we've had four or five sellouts. The people are back. The building is electric. Mike, you know what it's like in a Toronto-Buffalo game here. You've been to a bunch of those. But it's been that way for the games since then, too, since Toronto was in here. And the people are back. They're enjoying their Sabres, and they've straightened it out. They want to have a home identity, and they're starting to carve that out.
And doing it without four guys on their blue line out due to injury right now, how have the Sabres been playing without those guys?
I think it's their depth has been tested here. Either 7D, they've had four out. Matt Hunwick's been out for the year. He is just starting his rehab assignment in Rochester. So we might see him soon. Scandella, we might see the next game. He's been out probably for about a week and a half. Jake McCabe, who's been their best defenseman, is on a week-to-week basis, and Casey Nelson's been out. That's tough to overcome, and as you mentioned coming in, they finally won a game after losing five in a row, and I think they really hadn't had injuries up to that point. They went through November and never had to call anybody up to play. Now they've seen Lawrence Pilot in the lineup. Matt Tennyson has been in the lineup. Both will be in the lineup on defense today. So they've had to start testing their depth in Rochester a little bit, too.
All right, Paul, I got to ask about the tie. Certainly a festive one there. But, of course, we're on Arena Cam right now, so we might as well be talking to you from the Hubble telescope. Tell us what specifically is on that tie. It looks unbelievable from here.
Well, yeah, we have Bugs Bunny. We have all Bugs' friends on there. I have about five Christmas ties that I alternate starting last game, and I'll alternate them right through Christmas. So I had a Christmas lights tie on the last game. So I have a bunch of them that I enjoy. I like cartoon ties.
I like it, and we enjoy your insight as well. So keep using those ties while you can right now before we hit 2019, and we'll see if the Sabres can keep it going on home ice tonight. Paul, thank you. This big tilt tonight, we welcome in Mitchell Clinton, Jets TV reporter right there. Mitchell, where have the Jets improved the most through the first 30 games this season?
Well, one of the things that always comes to mind when you think of the Winnipeg Jets is the offense. I mean, anytime you got Patrick Laine, Mark Scheifele, Blake Wheeler, Kyle Connor, Brian Little, you just keep on going. You're going to do well on the offensive side of things. I mean, they're top 10 in goals for, top 10 in goals for per game. But what Paul Maurice has really noticed has gotten better, especially since the Global Series trip, is how the team has played defensively. Now, earlier in the year, the way that they would generate offense, they weren't really happy with. Now they've gotten back to playing in a strong, fundamentally sound defensive game, and that's churned into some good offense. So what they've been able to do is they've been able to creep back up in that goals against per game and goals against into the NHL's top 10, which is where they'd like to keep it. The penalty kill, when they do end up in the box, is also in the top 10. So a lot of value, I think, is in those, getting into that spot in the National Hockey League, a good indicator that you're a consistently good team overall. And they've also noticed that teams are kind of defending them a little bit differently. That third forward is staying up a little bit higher in the Jets off in the Jets defensive zone so that the Jets can't transition back with speed. Now, sure, that leads to some easy breakouts, perhaps, but it makes the neutral zone a little bit more clogged. So the Jets have shown good commitment to their game, some good patience to be able to put up with it, stick with their game, and the offense comes from there.
You mentioned special teams, top 10 in PK. How about top 10 in power play as well, as in number one in the entire league right now, just over 30%, Mitchell. What makes this unit so effective?
Yeah, and in and around 35% in this building at Bell MTS Place, but it's been both units. I mean, a lot of the attention gets paid to the Wheeler, Scheifele, Laine, Byfuglien, Kyle Connor unit, and for good reason, of course. But it's also been the second unit, especially on this homestand with Matthew Perreault. He scored a big power play goal against the Chicago Blackhawks to extend the lead from 4-3 to 5-3. And I kind of asked him about what's been going well for the second unit as of late. He just said, we're just being a little bit more opportunistic. We're cashing in on some opportunities like Perreault did. But one thing to notice with the Jets power play and how the teams are killing against them is they're taking away those seam passes to Scheifele and Laine, and why wouldn't you? But when you have the options that the Jets do, they're using the point a lot more often. Dustin Byfuglien had three assists against the Blackhawks, two of which came on the power play from point shots. Jacob Trouba and Josh Morrissey also contributing from the point on the blue line of late.
We always talk about Patrick Laine when we talk Winnipeg, and we often hear about the youngster Kyle Connor as well. What about that line, and what kind of impact a guy like Brian Little has on that trio?
Well, absolutely massive. I mean, anytime that they're starting in the defensive zone, Brian Little is the second best center in terms of defensive zone faceoff wins on this team. And both he and Adam Lowry have players in the National Hockey League that have taken at least 300 draws. Both of them are in the top 15 in terms of defensive zone faceoffs. So obviously two guys that they really rely on. And as for Brian Little, I mean, defensively, he's extremely responsible, always below the puck as a center, helping out those wingers in Kyle Connor and Patrick Laine to have the offensive success that they're having. But that line is also having some sustained offensive zone time, which has been huge for a player like Patrick Laine and Kyle Connor. And I talked a little bit about faceoffs. Todd Woodcroft is the assistant coach that gives video to all the Jets centers of the centermen that they're going to be facing that night. He says he can always rely on Brian Little to watch that video and even make some tweaks to a really skilled arsenal that he already has.
All right, Arsenal versus Arsenal tonight as far as weapons goes. Oilers and Jets from Bell MTS Place in Winnipeg. Mitchell, thank you very much. Something that we saw earlier in this game, Andre Vasilevskiy coming. If we had a penalty box, you'd be in it for all the infractions you've just committed. But Andre Vasilevskiy, the first shot he faces rings the iron. You saw something that stood out to you as far as how Ryan McDonagh played that 2-on-1.
It was an odd way, and I think we're finding fundamentally, Mike, that the 3-on-2s, the 2-on-1s, the basics of the game aren't being played the right way. Defensemen, for whatever reason, leaving their skates, not taking the right player on the 2-on-1. But here, after the pass was made, I found it interesting that Ryan McDonagh would inexplicably leave his skates and dive towards the puck carrier that has already shot the puck, which, as you said, was Nylander. And if that rebound were to come to Andreas Janssen, he's all alone. The defenseman's in no shape whatsoever. I just didn't understand it. He's such a solid defenseman that makes good decisions.
Yeah, and I understand maybe you want to attack the puck or try to seal it off, but generally speaking, you never want to dive face first at anyone, because guess what? You can't stop.
Mm-hmm. No.
There is no breaks when you go face first. So, I mean, at least if you go feet first.
How about we demo it? We're here. We might as well demo how you play 2-on-1.
Do I need a stick?
Okay, this is not a good move.
You can dig your skates in if you go feet first, but if you go face first, you have nothing but gravity to stop you.
What were coaches telling you guys? Because Scott Stevens hates when people go down on the 2-on-1.
Why don't you get in there on the 2-on-1 and I'll be the D.
So back.
You're driving harder than that.
Sure, no stick. That's how I play my best.
All right, you're a decoy right now.
All right.
So back in the day, it used to be, make sure I can't make the pass, leave the shooter to the goaltender. Mm-hmm. And as long as Panger's job was to make sure that you don't get a puck and dump it in the empty net so that goalie can come out, be aggressive, trust in his defenseman that he can't be beat, kind of almost one-on-one. You crowd him, so it's a bit of a...
Crowd a little bit. You don't want to give him the... You don't want to give him a breakaway.
But I think what we're seeing now, and I think what coaches have decided, is that it's better to challenge guys to make a pass, trust your goalie to get over there, and react to maybe a bobbling puck or a last-second decision. So now Panger is going to run at me instead of just sitting in the middle and test whether I can beat the goalie under duress, make a pass under duress, and then it's a one-on-one with the goaltender. It's been a change of philosophy. It really absolutely has. And you see a lot more defensemen now running at guys, challenging guys, sliding at guys. And then if you make the pass, it's wide open. You basically have a breakaway, but
with no stick.
With no stick.
Taking a look out west, the playoff picture here, and some of the normal names that we're used to seeing in the playoff picture, but some of the teams that we're not used to seeing. How about the Blues, the Blackhawks, the LA Kings? They're so far down that they're not even on the playoff picture.
It's a bad sign
right now. Yeah, dead last.
They're only one point behind the Hawks. They could leapfrog the Hawks. They have 24 points.
To get into our graphic.
Yes.
As far as the playoff picture, I think they have a whole lot more work to do. And you were saying earlier in the show that you look at the West and it just looks weird. Something we haven't seen from these powerhouse teams out West in the last couple of seasons. Which one stands out to you the most that maybe had the higher expectations this year that just hasn't lived up to them?
Well, I think the changes that the St. Louis Blues made in the offseason, I mean, this isn't just a local flavor that I'm giving you. You ask anybody around the National Hockey League.
That's the answer.
Then that's the answer. Everybody was talking about St. Louis and what they added and getting Ryan O'Reilly and obviously adding Bozak, bringing back David Perron that had 60 points last year, and Patrick Maroon, the hometown guy that really invested in himself, only signing a one-year deal. Word is that he had a couple of other contract offers that were multiple years, but he chose to go back home where his son lives, and it was a big emotional return for Patty. But, you know, right off the get-go, the guys just... At the very beginning, the gelling part of the game is such an important part of the game, and it's like with so many new forwards, they just couldn't find their space, and one game led to another game, led to another game. But make no mistake, they still go into Billings. They went into Colorado and won. They went into Toronto and dominated 1-4-1. They went into Winnipeg and won 1-0. So they have that ability, but for whatever reason, guys, they can't keep that sustainable. And that's one thing that they're trying to figure out right now under Craig Berube.
I think the one question mark for St. Louis heading into the season was their goaltending.
Yep.
And whether Jake Allen, who has been around the Blues for 4 or 5 years now, had different moments where they allowed him to be the number one. And he's shown himself to be a great goalie for stretches, but also pretty inconsistent. His lows are quite a bit away from his highs. And, you know, 8.99 save percentage for a team that had visions of winning the Central Division is not going to get it done. So they got issues, but they're still good. I mean, they could turn it around, they could go on a run, and they have the pieces to be a good, relevant team this year. I look at Chicago, and listen, you trade what's happening this year for what happened the previous 10.
Yeah.
I mean, they won 3 Cups. They're a great team. They restored that franchise to great prominence in the NHL. But you look at their core, and these are the guys that have been there through all their cups, and 30 to 35 years old, all signed for 4 or 5 more seasons, all making a ton of money, which I understand why they got those contracts. Now, Patrick Kane and Taves are actually still probably playing on par with that. We know Corey Crawford's been injured. But when you have $40 million invested in 5 guys who are on the wrong side of 30, no matter how great they are, it's going to be hard to retool and reload. They probably won't bottom out maybe to get all the way to the bottom and finish last, although they're on their way right now. But they're also very difficult to move those contracts. They all have no-move protection, which they earned. So just how Stan Bowman's trying to navigate out of this mess, get the players, reload, reset, whatever you want to call it, when you have those great core five taking up that much money is just a task that is monumentally difficult. And then you throw Jeremy Colton, who, you know, I don't feel bad for anyone. They're in the NHL.
Yep.
They're there for a reason. He's a professional. He's in a really tough spot. Replacing one of the all-time greats, replacing the voice that led those 5 guys to all those wins. He's younger and was a teammate of some of those players, and he's going in there and trying to turn things around and change things up. It's very difficult for him, and the results show how difficult
Johnny,
it is.
Johnny, you don't want to be the next one.
You want to be the,
you want to be the one after the
I
next one.
I want to be the one after. I want the one after the one after.
I've heard great things about Jeremy.
Yeah.
I mean, as a coach, whether overseas or at the American League level, and you don't just get to be a coach in the NHL without having a bit of a resume and a reputation. So he's doing some things well. But, you know, to try to grab onto the attention of everybody and get them playing the way the rest of the NHL is playing when you're so heavy at one side of it. I think that this team can bounce back, but it's going to take some shrewd trades, and it's going to take Perlini to be a real consistent player. They just 2-for-1 to deal. That's a classic move. You know, move one asset, get two back.
Yep.
They need some depth, so it's a worthwhile gamble.
And Strom's been actually okay.
And Strom's been okay, and he plays with DeBrincat. I know we go back to their OHL days together where they had some chemistry, but they got, you know, 4 legs versus 2 and see where it goes from here.
Yep.
But that's a real struggle because the pride of everybody there, led by Rocky Wirtz, has done a magnificent job of putting them back together. I think they'd like to see these guys end their careers as Chicago Blackhawks. That
just
may or may not happen.
Might not be possible. So they're in tough.
Yep. And then LA, we mentioned them, who's dead last in the league right now. So who would have thought that those three teams would be in the conversation for the Jack Hughes pick?
Look at the names.
Wouldn't have thought.
Goodness,
look at the names on this list, though. I mean, those are.
So what do the Kings do?
I think they even have less options than Chicago. Because I think the Chicago Five, if you can get those guys to want to trade their, willing to wade their no moves, you can trade the Chicago players and get assets back.
Mm-hmm.
You know, I don't know what you're going to get for Dustin Brown or Andre Kopitar, or not Andre Kopitar, but Ilya Kovalchuk and Kyle Clifford, those kind of players. Drew Doughty just re-signed. He's not going anywhere.
Tell you what, Dustin Brown's playing well. I think he'd be a player that there'd be some contenders that can use that speed, that experience.
I still think
the way he plays, I think he's I do, because he gets around the ice and he finishes checks and there's an element to his game.
Because they play slow.
They do.
They don't have always slow players, but they play slow.
Well, they played in straight lines for a long time under Daryl.
Mm-hmm.
And Daryl is
Daryl Sutter.
Daryl Sutter. It's such a disciplined way of playing. Yeah. I mean, your wingers are literally
They're locked in.
It's left wing. It's center iceman coming deep. And in fact, Willie DeJardins and their coaching staff, and I know talking to Rob Blake and the guys, they're like, you know, we could use our guys going that way a little bit quicker, but they're so disciplined in coming back and playing the 200-foot game game's not being played anymore.
Never heard a coaching staff encouraging their players to cheat.
Yeah, right?
Cheat on the offensive side a little bit more.
We'll flip it out.
Yes, sir.
Over my
ears.
Right?
Yeah.
So it's just bizarre world.
What about a Jeff Carter?
For those, Jeff Carter could go a lot of places to help.
Darn right.
If he's willing to go somewhere.
Yep.
So we'll see, but it's just This is the price you pay. This is the cyclical nature of sports.
Yeah.
You're really good. You don't draft well. You trade assets to get even better, to take runs at cups. You win a couple. If you're LA, if you're Chicago, you've come up short. If you're St. Louis, but they've been also really good. And eventually,
you take that, though. The good with the bad,
always
right?
Take.
They got their two. They got two cups.
They got two. Chicago.
A lot of teams would like that.
So. They got nothing to complain about for another 15
exactly.
years.
Exactly. It buys you more time. Just any rink demo. How about a super demo here with the guys, Panger Johnny, and we're joined by Reeder and Weeksy. Weeksy's got the gear on, so I know goaltending is certainly going to factor in this one. Andre Vasilevskiy back in net tonight for Tampa, one of the bigger goaltenders that we have in the league. What's it like for these big guys facing these guys out here, or more importantly, I should say, what's it like for these guys facing a big goaltender these days?
Yeah, we kind of have everything covered because we have you, you're coaching.
No, I'm out of here.
Which I like
Goodbye.
Your coaching. All right, now we got Panger, so we got a bit of a shorter tender, and we got Reeder, defensive specialist, and we got Johnny as our offensive guy and our goal scorer. So we're just going to talk a little bit about Andre Vasilevskiy being back, what it's like for him, and him being a big goalie, Vezina Trophy finalist too, coming off of a great year, and what it looks like when you see him in the net. He's a lot more physically imposing. So if you see his size compared to that of the average NHL goalie today, 6'2 and a half, fellas.
Weeksy,
pretty tall.
That's basically you, right? You're just on.
Close.
You're 6'2.
Yes, we might have to tweak the 202.
Yeah, well, you played at 200.
Yeah, exactly. We might be. But Panger, take us through this right here.
Well, I went into Tampa Bay to do a feature back then with TSN, and we did the swap of the equipment. Ben Bishop said something funny to me, because I'm 5'4½. I played in the NHL 135 pounds, and he said, I wouldn't wear these goalie pads in street hockey as a kid. Those were the last pads that I ever got, and I ended up retiring and never wore them in the NHL. But there is a bit of a significant difference because the pads are 30.
The crazy part is your pads
39.
Are wider than his.
Yeah.
Oh, that's true. We did cheat. My one pad was 14 inches wide, but it was 27 inches high.
Wow.
Who's going to say, that my pads look too big?
Right.
Nobody would have said that.
That's fair. That's fair.
Didn't really help my stats anyway.
Sure. So now basically what's interesting about it, right, is you guys are coming in and you're shooting on a bigger goalie versus a smaller goalie. So, Johnny, you're just saying something off camera.
So
take the viewers inside what you're thinking if you're shooting on a bigger goalie, so to speak.
Generally speaking, bigger goalie, they cover more net. That is their advantage. That's why they are now averaging 6'3 and 200-plus pounds, because just when they are there as a shooter, and I'm going to shoot on Kevin, average-size NHL goalie right now, I don't see as much. His shoulders are high. They're above the crossbar. His legs are out towards the post. I don't see a lot of room to shoot in the four corners.
Mm.
And I don't like shooting up here because you might hit that.
Yeah.
But the one thing I do find I see more of when I shoot against bigger goalies is their fivefold, because their legs are longer, their feet get a little bit wider, and I see a little bit more room in here. Now, I didn't like shooting fivefold because I wasn't very good at it. I didn't shoot it well enough. But that's the one spot where you see less room always. The one spot where I would see more is between the legs of a bigger goaltender versus a smaller one who may be a little tighter, not quite as much in there. So if you want to shoot him, try to get him through there, you can. But
pretty easy.
I was not good at that one. That was the one place. Other than that, it's obviously advantage bigger goaltender, like a Vasilevskiy, they come back because they just have the size to take up the net.
The other reason that players shoot five-hole a lot, and I think shooting five-hole is great when you're moving. So if I'm coming in, especially coming in off my off-wing,
right?
If I'm coming in here and I start to move to the middle, you have to plant on one foot and separate.
Right.
So as you're doing that and I'm moving, I've got to shoot it as I'm moving, which you have to open up. You
of
just
course.
Can't.
Can't bunny hop over.
You can't slide over.
Yeah, exactly.
It doesn't
happen.
Shuffles. And the other reason, that's one way that I always look at it, especially playing alumni. We don't play in the league anymore, but I do play the odd
alumni
time.
Games,
you get out, and you're not zipping pucks high anymore. The goaltenders are just too quick, usually much younger, but they have to move. So you see a lot of guys are doing that, especially when they're moving. And the other reason in the NHL to do it is, where are the rebounds created? Rebounds aren't created from here.
No.
If they hit here, it's out here. Rebounds are created when the shot comes from here to here, and you score most of the goals in the National Hockey. You're scoring most of the goals on second, third scoring opportunities. And so if you're shooting for a rebound, you might go five hole. You see a lot of shots are also maybe inside the post or here. But if you're shooting in this area, you have a better chance of getting a second scoring opportunity if the save's made.
The old pass-off pad is
exactly.
a big play nowadays.
Yeah. Yes, it
absolutely.
Is. Go for the second opportunity, not the first one.
And one other thing that players like shoot at, Kev, you want to get down in your butterfly, if you can.
Yeah.
Careful now. Now,
exactly.
We see all kinds of goals, the six hole, the seven hole, underneath here, between the body and their hands. And again, for bigger goaltenders now, their levers are longer. So they got more to get down because they're just further away from the body. So another part where you see guys, and I don't even know if they do this on purpose. I think some really skilled guys might shoot, trying to bang it through this hole or maybe slip it under their But I think just knowing that if they elevate and get it just off the body gives themselves a chance to squeak it through those underarm plays. Because you try to go top glove, pick and cherries. I mean, the goaltenders are just so quick with their gloves. So when the scramble, they come up, if you can get it kind of banking through there, that is a more difficult place for bigger goaltenders, perhaps, to squeeze down just because they're a little bit taller.
And with the equipment, changes,
yeah,
that area is
now a little trim down on the biceps,
a little more space,
and the chest protector a little tighter.
Exactly. When you're having to go, as you said, having to go from here to there.
Yeah.
We've got some more B-roll though. You can go ahead and throw to that, Steaks. We got some more B-roll on Andre Vasilevskiy, and what's interesting about it is watch him, great position, out up on top of his crease. And still really mobile, Panger, but in instances like this, he's playing to his size, which is something that's good to see because we also see other instances where goalies are big, but they also play smaller. So just run us through this montage, Panger.
Yeah, and I agree with you. And I think for a larger goaltender, less is more, and it's hard to explain less is more. And sometimes, as you see in that video clip, that Vasilevskiy works real hard on secondary chances because he tends to do a lot. Mm-hmm. He's very active. His feet are active. Whereas, you know, Ben Bishop is a good example of a guy that throughout his career, he's been taught and told, and it's been reiterated, less is more. You're big. Less is more, you know. And
let your size do the work.
Let the size do the work. And you don't have to go outside. This is the crease right here. The net's only 6 feet. You don't have to go out here. You just have to play the post and stay inside the post and have good control of it.
Come this way for a second.
All right, so I got to ask you a question, Panger.
Go ahead.
So we see Vasilevskiy on top of the blue paint.
Okay.
All right, so when you played, how far out from the blue paint were you?
I was top of the crease.
See, that's amazing because if you're both on top of the crease and we're coming in, you're not thinking five hole on you because we're going to see more net, just size, total stature-wise, especially
if you're talking about a breakaway. I think I was classic old school where you start out and I try to back and time it back and in with you.
You would have to be because in the game where we played against each other, you would have to come out because, I mean, we had Alan Bester was our goaltender in Toronto and Al wasn't much taller.
Little guy.
Same thing. There were a lot of little goaltenders who played. And they challenged because there was so much more net when you're looking at if you decided to stay inside the blue, no matter where you are. You're just seeing, it's just that your shoulders are on top.
Mike Smith can do this.
Yes. It's crazy,
and even then, he's guilty of playing too deep in his net.
Henrik Lundqvist, another guy who sits at the goal line.
Yeah,
absolutely.
There's no margin for error. If it trickles through your arm and you're on the goal line, it's going to go in. If you're out here and it trickles through your arm, you might have a chance to sweep it behind you.
Panger, I want to get one quick thing in for bigger goalies that sometimes play a little bit small. Maybe you could show the difference between a big guy crouching and making himself small and you being a quote-unquote undersized guy and making yourself look
bigger. Quote-unquote, he's undersized.
He's a small goaltender.
Well, for number one, it's patience. Like Wayne Thomas was my goalie coach, and he was the best at teaching patience. Now, what exactly is that? For me, it was staying on my skates for as long as I possibly could, staying on my edges. And even goalies of this day, like when Carey Price is running into trouble, he's sliding.
Yes.
And he's not staying on his edges with patience. When I was at my best, I could actually see a puck come off the blade of your stick and I wouldn't move. There was going to be no movement from me. So I played a game like this.
Right.
When I was younger, I was all over the place and I was a butterfly goaltender like Mike Palmateer and I was reckless. And then I became a patient, calm goaltender. And you, to your point earlier, the five hole, so my five hole, if I spread my legs like this, my five hole was still very small. Most guys would shoot it and hit me right here.
Right.
So it was an easy save for me if I just stood there because they couldn't hit that five hole. It was just... there wasn't enough room.
Yeah.
Take your advantage where you can. Listen,
absolutely.
I think we got some clips of Panger playing that patient style.
Oh.
We got anything? There he is.
That's at the garden.
There he's the patient.
Oh,
the club saving a beauty, Panger. Okay. That's the Iserman you took that one away from?
Sorry, Stevie Y.
Yeah, that's all right.
Your boy.
Pay it back. There he is on top of the crease.
Too. Saddle club.
I don't know about textbook there, but he's a battler. Paddle down.
What do we got here?
Get over there and watch your left hamstring.
Nice.
Wait a second. I've never been 156 pounds. That's
nobody your gear
nobody
on.
Complains
I'm not even 156
I've never
now.
Heard a goaltender complain that they were listed as too heavy.
We're giving you a little size. Take it.
We're building you up here.
Yeah, use it to your advantage, man.
156.
I was 130, 135.
135. 138
that's
now.
A, 156 was with equipment. That's with
yes, that's
yeah, exactly.
Soaking wet.
See what happens? Give us pucks, sticks, gear. We're going to have fun for about 20 minutes. Scotty, right? I know you're over there somewhere. Get us out of here.
I'm here and I live for Weeksy in his prime and Panger in his prime. Those clips. The game is a gift. Visit your local retailer or Bauer.com for great holiday gifts. It is time for the NHL Hat Trick Challenge presented by Enterprise. Scott Braun and Kevin Weeks, one-on-one. You ready?
Let's do it, of course. Okay. Let's do this.
Let me see. Let's just do a straight-up game to start us off. Bruins against the Penguins. Pick a winner for us.
I'm going to go with the Bruins. I'm going to go with the Boston Bruins in this game. The Penguins have been inconsistent for me this year. We know that they've got the superheroes. They certainly do. But so too do the Boston Bruins. And I love the way that Pasternak has played this season. Of course, him and Marchand with that magic, plug Krejci in there in the absence of Bergeron. They've been outstanding. Nice having McAvoy back in the lineup, too. He's a game changer for them. Torrey Krug continues to be solid. The goaltending's really good. I'm going to go with the Bees in this one.
Are you ready to get fancier?
Of course. Let's do it. Take your time with it, though.
Okay. Let me make sure I get this out correctly. Will Detroit score at least 4 goals at home against the Ottawa Senators? Yes or no?
I'm going to say yes. I hear some people in my ear in our control room that are from Michigan. Say yes, man. Say yes, man. Yeah, I'm going to say yes. I had that before any of you got to whisper in my ear, okay? So easy, Sterling Heights, Michigan. I got this. Yes, I think the Wings end up getting 4. They're a little bit more offensive this year. I love the way Nyquist is playing. Dylan Larkin, Athanasiou, they're making strides. Keep an eye on Chalowski. I talked to Jimmy Howard about him the other day. And he said that this kid is a really, really good player. He's got a lot of upside. He's just hitting his stride right now as a rookie defenseman.
Okay, so let me highlight another individual playing for a team that is suddenly scoring. Will Leon Draisaitl score at least 1 goal? Oilers at home against the Philadelphia Flyers.
Why not? It's been a tough season up and down for the Flyers. They're in a state of flux, in a state of transition. And the fact that Draisaitl has been reunited with Connor McDavid, that's one of the best duels in the world right there. So they control the game. They control the puck. They dictate. Not only control, they dictate offensively against opposing teams. All that to say, I think Draisaitl gets on the board for sure against the Flyers.
I'm feeling these positive vibes.
Yeah, I'm climbing. See? Benny Seltzer and Big Game James here in our studios. Look over your shoulders. You NHL fans, too.
End of the week. We're feeling good. He's got the Bruins taking down the Penguins and the Wings scoring at least 4 against the Senators and Draisaitl with at least 1 against Philadelphia. So play NHL Hat Trick Challenge daily for the chance to win the $20,000 regular season grand prize and until January 25th for your chance to win the $10,000 period 2 prize. Let's bring this outside. Time for Top Outdoor Moments. Presented by Discover. Let's take you back to when Mike Condon was in his home state of Massachusetts on the opposition for the Canadiens, making 27 saves in a victory. And correct me if I'm wrong, both of you were there?
This is correct.
Yes.
He was amazing in this game. He was so awesome in this game. It's probably the best game Mike Condon played as an NHLer. He had some really good ones in Montreal, some good ones in Ottawa as well, especially when Craig Anderson was out due to his family's battle with his wife's cancer. But what I remember most about that is his dad is a Boston PD cop. And his dad was at the game. And I remember the emotions and the embrace between him and his father. So that was a real special moment for him. One I'm sure he's always going to remember in his backyard being a Boston native.
Absolutely. The weather was fantastic in that game, as I recall. But what I remember that game is Brendan Gallagher was on fire. He had a hand injury. Mm-hmm. He'd been out a long time. Right. I remember we called the game with Steve Mears for NHL Network International. And Gallagher came back. And this was a game where the Habs hadn't been playing that well. And they dominated the first period and ended up dominating the game. Also, Bruins fans remember Matt Beleski scored a goal in the game. Didn't score many for the Boston Bruins, but he actually scored in that game. And this game was all Connor's game. He was outstanding after the first period because it was all Montreal in the first period. I remember we continued to talk through this game about who's got the advantage, the visiting team or the home team. And it was true that the visiting team had the advantage early. And then the visiting team with Connor and Annette had the advantage in the second and third because Connor was that good. But that was the return. I can remember Brendan Gallagher, and it was a huge part of that offensive part of the team. And the team had been struggling, the Canadians, and the Boston Bruins had been playing very well up to that point, and Montreal dominated the first period. And that building, there was over 60,000 people at Gillette Stadium. The place was so quiet. And those games, you just want because there's so many people. You want to see the home team score early so you can have the eruption of the crowd and just see the excitement. Didn't happen for a while, especially the Montreal-Boston rivalry, and the fans were not happy that Mike Conlon stole the show in the second and third.
Mm-hmm. It's hard for me to feel bad for Boston fans.
They win at everything.
Especially in that stadium.
You win at everything. That's the house TB12 built right there.
Exactly.
Hey, quickie, that morning too, Coach Belichick and Coach Claude Julien were on the ice together that morning.
That's cool.
I was standing at field/ice level. That was fun to see.
Clutch performance of the night presented by Bridgestone. And this one was easy, Weeksy, because Andre Vasilevsky had not played in over a month. He comes back, and he looks just as good as he ever has.
Just as good as he ever has. No save better than this one. He had about three of those last season where he went behind his back, en route to not only making the saves, but being a Vezina Trophy finalist last year. First game back, props to the Big Cat, tying a franchise best 48 saves his former
48?
Teammate. Ben Bishop, his first game. So you guys asked me in the pregame, in our meeting, pre-show meeting, what I thought, what we're looking for. Anything we're looking for is moot. He was great. I talked to somebody with the Tampa Bay organization. They said the chances were 30-10, scoring chances in favor of the Leafs. 30-10. This is a stolen win. Yes, the Bolts put up some goals, but Vasilevsky was absolutely miraculous in his return. Special. Special.
It's interesting we're talking about Vasilevsky doing this and the fact that he just comes back. Usually we're talking about Freddie Anderson on the other side.
Yes.
But there's no question. Both of these teams can turn it up offensively. The Leafs turned it up offensively and got stoned. And it wouldn't have surprised me if it was the other way around, if Tampa Bay turned it up offensively and Anderson stoned him. So this battle of the two top teams in the National Hockey League is going to continue all season long. It was exciting. It was a fun game to watch. But Vasilevsky, some of the stops that he made, the acrobatic one that we saw, the way he pulls the puck out off of Marlowe, and or be able to get it with his pad in the foot, sliding it up. But some of the other stops he made where he just made himself big, he comes across, he shuts things down, he's so strong. And when Tampa is not scoring and outscoring the other team, Vasilevsky's the guy who keeps him in games. Well, he kept him in the game to a point where they got the two late goals in the second period to really stretch this game out. But it was Vasilevsky who won the game for them before that. He didn't score any goals, but he kept his team in the game even though they were getting outplayed, outchanced. It was the goaltender for Tampa that was the difference, and he deserves the 2 points, and I'm sure Tampa Bay's happy to see him back.
That's another overtime game winner presented by EA Sports NHL 19. Colton Sissons, what's this attack like?
It's a beautiful play by Bonino. Bonino draws the defender all the way over to the boards. Watch this play. And that's Hutton. He draws him all the way to the boards. Beautiful sauce over to Sissons, who's literally coming right down Broadway. Opens up that blade. Perfect chip shot, top shelf, for the game winner. Exciting game all around, though.
It was.
Very good game.
Vancouver Canucks come back and get two late goals. The final goal shorthanded. They actually get two shorthanded goals in the game. But the final goal shorthanded to tie it up with the goaltender out in the dying seconds. And then Bonino with a beautiful goal himself, his fifth, earlier in the game.
Yeah.
And then he sets that one up. And I love the way you talk, but just pulls the defender over a little bit too far and just sauces it to the middle. And Sissons, wow, what a shot. That's a tough shot, crossbody, to quickly just twist it. It's a timing play. You've got to be able to just twist the wrist quick enough with enough leverage on the puck to put it up and in. Great goal.
Really nice.
Congrats.
What a game. Hey, but before that, though, one thing I want to add on this, the Canucks played exceptionally well here. We are looking at these young teams going into hostile buildings tonight, and they go into Bridgestone Arena against a team that's a Stanley Cup contender in the Preds, who are an outstanding team, now 13-5-0 at home ice after tonight's win. But they get the extra point. They tie the game late. They show a lot in this game. Their young stars are a lot of fun to watch. I like the way the Canucks are trending right now as a team.
I don't know if they're in the Jack Hughes Derby
for
the 2019 draft, the number one overall in the lottery, although they might, I guess you get a lottery ball if they don't make the playoffs.
Sure.
So I guess you're still in it. But they're not officially in it, let's say, as one of the top teams to be at the bottom of the league. But they are still going to have Quinn Hughes, his brother, come in on the back end, and he's going to be a welcome addition. That, because this is a team that's got some great young forwards. We saw it with Pettersson. We saw Horvat score. We saw Besser score. You put that fleet of foot, fast-moving defenseman Quinn Hughes into this lineup, and I wouldn't be surprised if it's not next season. It should be next season. I think he could probably play right now and help this team. This team's got a lot of great young players. Mm-hmm. Great future in Vancouver.
And it's a great point. I mean, two road teams we just saw that did lose, but they earned their point tonight. Who wants it in OT in Winnipeg?
Ice for McDavid. McDavid brings it to the middle of the ice, off the goal post. Connor McDavid with the quick move to the middle of the ice, and he finds Pike on the blocker side of Hellebuck. Here comes McDavid again. Charges in. Morrissey got back to get a stick on it, and the Jets start back with Wheeler. Wheeler slows up at center. Wheeler sends it in for Shifley. On to Morrissey. Scores! Josh Morrissey in overtime! And the Jets win it 5-4.
Unbelievable patience in the neutral zone from Blake Wheeler as he has speed and numbers. It's a 2-on-1 and tight, but he recognizes that he...
That is your overtime game winner presented by EA Sports NHL 19. Josh Morrissey. What do you call him, Weeksy?
I love this kid. He's undercover good. Ooh. This is undercover good D-man. I really like his game. I think he shoots peas. He shoots peas. Very, very, very physical. Skates well. All situations defenseman. I think that they've got a nice undercover defenseman here. I talked to their general manager about him. Last week, Kevin Cheveldayoff, when they were here at the Garden, I said, I really like this player. And speaking of which, liking players, look at Connor McDavid just taking it himself.
I'll try this again. Post a little bit bigger. See, that's the hometown advantage, although they did switch ends. But the post a little bigger at the one end, obviously, because it goes off the pipe. And then Connor McDavid, after taking that double opportunity, can't get back fast enough. As you see him getting back late, he was right beside Josh Morrissey. After he did the second rush, Josh Morrissey jumps into the play. Tobias Enstrom was the young, fleet-footed, smaller defenseman for the Winnipeg Jets. Well, guess what? Josh Morrissey came in, and now it's Josh Morrissey's turn to be that young, fleet-footed, smallest defenseman with all sorts of skill on a team where everybody, if you're not 6'4", you're really not allowed to play on this team. Right. Because everybody other than a few guys are that size. Yeah. Look at the back end. You've got Bufflin, you've got Trouba, you've got Myers. And you've got Morrissey. He might be about 6 feet tall, but he looks like he's about 5'9 when he's out with the rest of them. But he is so smooth on the ice, jumps into the offense. When you're playing 3-on-3, it just shows you the confidence that the coach has of you to put you out there in the 3-on-3 situation, because he knows he brings the offense from the back end quietly on a team that is loaded with skill. Top to bottom, Winnipeg Jets. Mm-hmm. That was a great game.
Yeah,
really
it was.
Great game.
That
very exciting.
That was a great game. Game of the night.
Time now for the three stars of Thursday. The third star is Artemi Panarin, who lit the lamp twice in the Jackets' win against LA. For Panarin, it was his second multi-goal performance of the season. The second star is Nino Niederreiter, who extended his goal streak to 3 games with a 2-goal performance in Minnesota's 5-1 win against the Panthers. And the first star, you guessed it, the big cat, Andrei Vasilevskiy. In his first action since early November, Vasi made a career-best 48 saves to help the Bolts extend their win streak to 8 games.
There's been a different buzz in the building here all day long, right from the morning skate.
We are set here for the opening faceoff.
He'll bust in for a chance. He scores! What a goal!
2-on-1. Feeds it to the middle.
Every time, that puck needs to be shot as hard as you can, preparing to score.
Both teams can put them up with the best of them.
Steal by Cirelli, gets the feed back, cuts it along. Oh. Scores! It shoots off the crossbar.
A shot, save, rebound, poked away.
Save and a dandy.
Ready for that one.
Just stretches out, old school right there, makes the big save.
They must be able to be defensively sound each and every time they come over the boards.
And away they go and have a little dance.
All these players know that this should be a fun game tonight as two of the best go at it here in the National Hockey League.
He's coming 100 miles an hour.
Only one power play goal all season. In front, quick. How did he make that stop? Did the splits and was able to turn it aside.
Marcus Granlund cutting it off the left. Beagle deeps. He scores.
Marcus Granlund with the beautiful feed across to Jay Beagle after the steal.
Nylander found the net. A save by Vasilevskiy. What a great glove save there. Hedman saved another goal line.
Feel the puck with those pads on. Talk about having a feel for the game.
cranking it up now. Andre Svechnikov, near side, right in for a chance, and he scores! What a goal! Andre Svechnikov with a power move to his backhand, right to the house.
Who starts back in for Minnesota. Niederreiter, centers, Parisi, save by Reimer! What a terrific stop by the Panther goaltender.
Steal by Cirelli, gets the feed back, cuts it along, scores! Anthony Cirelli, a shorthanded goal!
Now here's some open ice for Ryan Hartman. Fires and he scores!
And you can see that he uses the defenseman perfectly on that one, right through the legs, it might have tipped his stick blade, and right through Anders Nielsen.